Excellent. Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. We're going to have a good time today. And I hope you're prepared to have a good time today. So you know, I'm gonna invite you to stretch a little and wiggle your shoulders a little bit and get ready, because today's all about dance. Because our lectionary passage today is talking about when King David danced before the Lord with all his might. So there's going to be some dancing today, and we're going to invite you to participate. But while we get started, I want to invite you to do just a couple of housekeeping things. The red books here are in the middle, in the center aisle, or right along the center aisle. If you just let us know that you're here, names, you can give us some information. If your address, your email address has changed, if a phone number has changed, this is a great way to keep us in the loop. So just let us know, and you can put that in here. Also, in your pews, our little blue cards, there it goes. These are our joys and concerns cards. If you have a prayer that you would like lifted up later on in the service, you can write down your prayer here. If you would like a letter sent, one of our ministries is to have prayer letters sent to folks who might be recovering from surgery or going through a hard time in their life. This is a wonderful ministry. You can check a box on the front, put an address on the back, and those prayer letters will get written, and they'll be up in the back of the sanctuary for anybody who wants to sign. You don't need to know the person to sign it. And it's just a wonderful way for us to say, hey, we've held you up in prayer. So you can find these during the opening hymn, or really whenever in the first part of the service, if you want to bring those up and just put it in a basket, in the basket here. We'll pray for those later on in the service. My name is Pastor Rachel. I'm one of the pastors here along with Mark, and we invite you to fully participate. We welcome you here to worship with us, and we're glad that all have gathered on such a beautiful day. With that, let us go into our opening hymn. This is The Lord of the Dance. You know this one. We'll come in easy. You'll be prepared, and you'll feel like you know where this song is going. So let us sing together The Lord of the Dance. Let us worship God.
Thank you. we're going to read Psalm 24 responsively. You can turn in your red books to page 755, or you can read the words are going to be on the screen. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. For God has founded it upon the seas. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts. They will receive the blessing from the Lord. Such is the generation of those who seek the Lord. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the ruler of glory may come in.
Who is the ruler of glory?
The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the ruler of glory may come in.
Who is the ruler of glory? The word of the Lord.
Little ones here with us today, I want to invite the kids to come on forward. Come on up, guys. I've got a special treat. My niece and nephew from Colorado are out visiting us, so they're going to come up too. Come on up, and you can sit right here. They're shy and retiring like the rest of my family. Come and sit right up here. You can turn around and face me. All right, so And I've asked Anya May, my oldest daughter, to help me out this morning. As I said before, we're talking a lot about dance today. And Anya is one of the people who I know who loves to dance. I also love to dance. So she's going to help me out. So we're going to think through and experience a little bit of a bunch of different kinds of dance. You can see some examples right up here, right? You can see some dances. So what I want you to do, and Adam's going to help with this too, what I want you to do is think of different kinds of dance. They can be dance moves, like, do you know the moonwalk, right? You can do some moonwalk, right? Think of different kinds of dance moves or different kinds of dances and call them out, and we're going to try to do them. Some of these could go better than others. Okay, who can think of a kind of dance? Salsa. Can we do salsa? Adam, you got salsa back there? I can't do salsa. This is going to be very entertaining. How do we do salsa?
This works.
Okay, good. You can actually do this. Okay, so there's a little bit of salsa. All right, cool. What else we got? Yeah. Oh, hold on. What's that? Miss Jane's dance? I don't know. Ballet? Is that what she means by Miss Jane's dance? Ballet? Can we get a little ballet? Neither of us can ballet. This is going to be funny. Do you know ballet? Can you do ballet? Can you help us out? Show us a little bit of ballet. Ooh, I can do that. Like that? Like this? How about like this? Ooh, I think I hear the dance of the fairies. Like this? What do you think? I'm great at this. All right, what else have we got? What other kinds of dances are? Edward, you had one. What did you think? The floss. Apparently this is a thing. I haven't the foggiest. Anya's going to have to do this one. This is all the rage with middle schoolers right now. I have no idea. I can dab. All right, what else we got? What's that? I didn't have, this is the dab? All right, Anya said that I had to do the breakdancing. This is also going to be very entertaining. All right, have we got breakdance music? Okay. All right, I can't breakdance. I might break myself. I'm a little worried. Okay, what's that? It's break dancing, not break yourself dancing? All right, so I think I remember some of this from, see, when I was in middle school, this was kind of a thing. Have you got it? I can't really
break.
Something like that. You're welcome. All right, what else? What other kinds of dances are there? Yeah. Did you just say the worm? Because that's going to be really sad. Can you do the worm?
I can't do the worm.
Anya's going to pretend to do the worm. I think that's like the flobber worm. Can you do the worm? Show us. Can you show us the worm? Edward's got the worm. Awesome. What are the kinds of dances? Yeah. What's that? Messmates? What is it? Hey, wow, look at that. I don't even know what that was. What else? Exercise. This is all exercising. I heard something from back there before. Bruce, what did you say before? Can-can. I don't know if you've got can-can queued up, but I think we can do can-can. Ready? All right, that was good. That was enough. Yeah. Interpretive. This has all been interpretive.
Adam, what do we have for interpretive?
Oh, forget interpretive. Move on. Everybody, if I gotta do this, you gotta do this. Chicken dance. Yay. What other kinds of dance can you think? Yeah. Contra dancing. I don't know if we've got anything up for contra dancing, but let's see. We can contra dance. There we go. What was that, Scott? What, Robert? What was that? The Irish jig. Something like. Can you can dance. Get up here, Ruby. Ruby can do that. Good at it, look at that! Woo! Yeah! Woo! That was awesome! Very cool. Anything else? Can you guys think of others? Polka! Do you know how to polka?
No idea how to polka.
Do you know how to polka? One, two, I can do one, two, three, hop, but it's not gonna look like anything. How about swing dancing? Swing dancing. We got swing? All right, we're closing in here. I don't think we can do much more after this. This is such a hack. Minion dance? What do the minions do to dance? I can just think. Banana. That's the minion dance? Wait, is this a different dance? Which one? There are a lot of different kinds of dances, aren't there? Oh no, you thought of another one. What? Ballroom dancing. We do, and hip hop. You can do real break dancing. What do you got? Sleep and dance. I'm just about ready for the sleep and dance. time. I'm right there with you. So, disco. That was a good one, yeah.
We have that one. We have that one queued
up. All right, well. So, there are lots and lots of different kinds of dancing, right? And we could probably spend hours doing more dances. Oh, one of the ones that we had thought of before was this. You know what this is? This is the middle school awkward dance. That's one of our favorites. So, with all these different kinds of dancing, why are we talking about dancing at church? So the scripture we're going to read later, in just a little bit, actually, almost next, is talking about when David, King David, danced before the Lord with all his might, with total abandon. He didn't care what anybody around him thought, and he led the whole congregation in dancing. Have you ever danced and had somebody give you a funny look, like, what the heck are they doing? You've had that experience? Yeah, like, oh my God, why are you doing that? I think Christopher has been giving me that look that whole time we've been up here. No. Oh, and you're not Christopher. Sorry, Benjamin. And in this story, David's wife kind of looked at him sort of funny, like, what are you doing? What, you think that's cool? Like, what's up with this? And David says, you know what? I am going to dance before the Lord. I'm going to look like a holy fool, and I'm going to dance anyway. So, there are times when we dance in worship, where we're letting ourselves get out of ourselves and leave behind all of the worries about what we look like around other people and what we seem like and our you know, we're going to forget about getting all spruced up and being exactly right, and we're just going to dance with abandon before the Lord and have some fun with that. That's the idea of the scripture passage today. And I want, because I believe that dance is a big part of worship, I want to show you a clip. This is going to be instead of our anthem today. I want to show you a clip from The Prince of Egypt. Have any of you guys seen The Prince of Egypt?
No?
Have any of you guys seen The Prince of Egypt? The Prince of Egypt is a movie. It was DreamWorks. It's not Disney, it's DreamWorks. A DreamWorks movie, and it's about the story of Moses. When Moses led the people out of Egypt to freedom and eventually to the Holy Land, right? And so this is the, hold on, Catherine, this is the beginning of the story of the people of Israel as they're getting ready to go into the Holy Land. And the scripture we're going to read today isn't part of that story, but is kind of the culminating end of the arc of that story. It takes us from when the people were led out of Egypt, culminating in when the Ark of the Covenant was brought into Jerusalem. So we're going to watch some music and dancing at the beginning of the story of these people coming out of Egypt, and then we'll talk later about when these people danced before the Lord as they brought the Ark of the Covenant into Jerusalem. So, Adam, are we queued up for that video? Let's watch this. Is a metaphor about God that has to do with dancing. And for the adults, it's on the front portion of your bulletin. I put a quote in there about a kind of dance that we use to think about the Trinity, about God, Father, and the Holy Spirit, and God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit dancing together in the ways that we see people dancing together in unity. So we use dance all the time. So let's pray now. Let's pray for the courage to dance and the freedom to dance and the joy of dancing. Oh, beloved God, you call us into a holy dance. You call us to let go of ourselves and to hang on to you and to believe and to know that the freedom to dance is just a joy, and that we are called into joy with you. In your good name we pray. Amen. All right, you guys can go sit with your families. You can go to the Children's Worship Center. You can come down, sit down. We're going to listen to that story now about King David.
So I'm reading from 2 Samuel chapter 6 through verse 5, and then starting back up in 12 and going to the end of the chapter. David again gathered all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. David and all the people with him set out and went from Baal Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who is enthroned on the cherubim. They carried the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the new cart with the Ark of God, and Ahio went in front of the Ark. David and all the house of Israel were dancing before the Lord with all their might, with songs and lyres, harps, tambourines, and castanets, cymbals. So David went and brought up the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. And when those who bore the Ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed an ox and a fatling. David danced before the Lord with all his might. David was girded with a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the Ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of trumpets. As the Ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, looked out of the window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. They brought in the Ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent that David had placed for it. David offered burnt offerings and offerings of well-being before the Lord. And when David had finished offering the burnt offerings and the offerings of well-being, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts. And he distributed food among all the people, the whole multitude of Israel, both men and women, to each a cake of bread, a portion of meat, a cake of raisins. Then all the people went back to their homes, and David returned to bless his household. But Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, "How the king of Israel honored himself today, uncovering himself today before the eyes of his servant maids, as any vulgar fellow might shamelessly uncover him." David said to Michal, "It was before the Lord who chose me in place of your father and all his households to appoint me as prince over Israel, the people of the Lord, that I have danced before the Lord. I will make myself yet more contemptible than this, and I will be abashed in my own eyes. But by the maids of whom you have spoken, by them I shall be held in honor." And Michal, the daughter of Saul, had no child to the day of her death. The word of the Lord for the people of the Lord.
Not sure why I'm so hot and sweaty right now. Might have been all that dancing. Let us pray. Oh, beloved God, I pray that you would be in these words, that these words might inspire someone here in this congregation, and that where these words are merely mine, that no harm would be done. In your name we pray. Amen. I truly dislike earwigs. Most bugs don't really bug me, much less disgust me, but earwigs, I can't stand earwigs. If you aren't familiar with them, they're these little cockroach-type insects with little, like, scorpion attachments, these little pincers on the front. I think my particular dislike of them has to do with an old Star Trek episode where some vile creature was put into the ear of people and to torture them. I don't think they were actually earwigs, but in my childhood mind, those were earwigs. And I just can't stand them. They give me the heebie-jeebies. So why am I telling you about earwigs? I'll get back to that. But it has to do with a recent family trip. We were in Michigan last week, and on our way back, the earwigs will come into the story. Another quick story about last week's trip includes a nostalgic story about a dam near the current home of my in-laws. When my partner, Kurt, was growing up, his family, like many families, had certain rules about using inappropriate language. They weren't supposed to use it. For instance, the word damn. Now, Kurt is from a big family. There were 7 kids. There still are 7 kids. They're just bigger now. And if you've ever met Kurt, you know he has a little sarcastic, teasing, sometimes twisted sense of humor. This started young. Now, multiply that by 7. And imagine being the parents of this brood of 7 children. I would feel more sorry for his parents, except I know that they come by this humor honestly. Nonetheless, there were rules. So you can imagine the joy that these 7 youngsters had each time they passed by this particular landmark in their family's then favorite vacation spot. How many times can we possibly get away with saying the word damn and not get in trouble for it? Hey, look at the dam! Ooh, 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 I see the dam! Oh, there's the McDonald's by the dam! Now multiply that by 7. And it would go on and on and on. I just can't imagine what my in-laws were doing at this time. Probably trying really hard not to laugh. At least that's what I probably wouldn't even be trying. I'd just be laughing. Okay, why am I telling you this? Well, because I'm about to intentionally utilize the word damn in the next story. But I'm not talking about a landmark. And the story that I'm going to tell you, this parable, really, it was originally told to me by a church consultant who'd come to another church I was serving many years ago. And I'm going to use the word damn because that was how it was used in its original storytelling, but also because I think it is absolutely appropriate. It is an accurate use of the word damn, the D-A-M-N version. When we talk about the kind of behavior indicated, it is indeed damning both to the person exhibiting the behavior as well as to the people around them. So, without further ado, here's the story. Once upon a time, there was a prime minister who went to visit another prime minister in a foreign land. After dispensing with the usual pomp and pleasantries, they got down to the business at hand. I don't know what the business at hand was. It doesn't really matter. Trade disputes, border disputes, who knows? Whatever it was they were talking about in those days doesn't matter. What matters is what happened during this time. Suddenly, a door slams open, and a little man comes scurrying across the room and bends over into the hosting prime minister's ear to whisper something with great enthusiasm and distress. After a moment, the prime minister whispers something back to the little man, and this little man visibly calms and walks gracefully out of the room. The visiting prime minister doesn't say anything but observes this, and they continue with their conversation, but about 10 minutes go by, and there's another interruption. Oh, this time a woman rushes in. She's clearly angry and agitated, and she bustles up to the hosting prime minister and begins to loudly complain and berate before quickly being quieted, and he beckons her forward and whispers something in her ear, and she calms, and she walks out of the room. The visiting prime minister again watches this in silence. But the third time an interruption happens and this visible calming happens, he can't hold back his curiosity any longer, and so he says to his host, "What is it that you say to them that calms them down so quickly?" Oh, that, the hosting prime minister says. "Oh, I'm just reminding them about rule number 6. Rule number 6? Yeah. The visiting prime minister was impressed that his host had implemented a rule that could help calm people so readily, so he asked the obvious follow-up question, "What's rule number 6? Rule number 6 is, don't take yourself so damn seriously. The visiting prime minister gaped, and then he chuckled, and then he outright guffawed. "So, what are the other rules?" "Oh," says the hosting prime minister, "we've long since forgotten the other rules. This is the only one that seems to really matter. For tradition's sake, we still refer to it as rule number 6. Really, there aren't really any other rules that matter that much." Don't take yourself too damn seriously. It's a good rule. It's one that I try to employ with some regularity. I confess that it takes practice, and I don't always succeed. Sometimes I need reminding. But overall, rule number 6 is a consistent fixture in my day-to-day life. I find that when I do take myself too seriously, I tend to put my foot in my mouth, or I sometimes end up looking pompous and ridiculous. Sometimes I end up hurting the people around me. That's what I mean by damning. I'll judge someone based upon my own stupid standard, and then I'll get all persnickety about it, and end up, in the end, feeling pretty terrible about the whole thing. Generally, the consequences are unpleasant, so I try to avoid it by remembering rule number 6. King David knew rule number 6, even if he'd never heard this modern parable, which we can safely assume he didn't. But not taking himself too seriously is truly one of David's lifelong charms. He could be confident without being cocky. He could be humble without playing the martyr. He valued people, and above all, he placed his trust not in himself, but in God. It wasn't that he never made mistakes. He definitely made some mistakes. He made some big ones, if you remember some of the stories. But when confronted, he acknowledged it, and he tried to course correct. He seemed, by all accounts, to be a thoughtful, genuine human. And today's story is pretty much the epicenter of King David's life, and indeed, the epicenter of the ancient Hebrews story. We watched the beginning of their story. This is sort of the epicenter. And after this, a whole bunch of things are going to play out that are going to be complicated for David as an individual and the Hebrew people in general. But this is the epicenter, the ark coming to Jerusalem. In David's life, prior to this, he'd been a simple shepherd boy. He'd been a humble servant of God who slew a giant with only a stone. He was a musician who sang lullabies to a king who hated him. He was a fugitive who was merciful to his enemies. He was a gracious king in a divided kingdom. But now he was a king of a reunited land, and he was finally bringing the Ark of the Covenant to the center of this land, to Jerusalem, the new capital of the Hebrew people. And he danced. Oh, how he danced. He danced with abandon and without heed to his own dignity. He led his people in dancing and celebration, and he's the one who led the way. not everybody was impressed. As we read, his wife, Mikhail, was downright disgusted with him. The Message translation says this. This is how she said it. "How wonderfully the king has distinguished himself today, exposing himself to the eyes of the servants' maids like some burlesque street dancer, dripping with sarcasm." Mikhail needed someone to remind her of rule number 6. Now, we church people can sometimes get a little bit uptight like Mikhail, right? I mean, it's not just us. Lots of people can be. But church people have become a bit of a stereotype. Am I right? We need to take a page out of David's book and loosen up. Dance before the Lord. Make holy fools of ourselves. Joy is a choice we get to make every single day, maybe many times a day. Let's choose it. So, we were traveling home from Michigan last week and decided to stop just north of Niagara Falls for the night. Kurt had booked us a room that seemed decent enough online. It took us a bit to find the place. As it turns out, it was in the middle of a college campus. Address had said nothing about this. Strange, but okay. By the time we walked in, it was about 10 p.m. We were tired, road weary, a little sore from our journey. The lobby, and I use that term loosely, looked more like a dorm entrance than a hotel. But whatever. We checked in and we walked down the hall to our room. Yeah, this was definitely a dorm. Cinder block walls, very bleak. We couldn't get into our room. We stood there trying the key several times. So we walked back down the hallway to get the key redone, and then we walked back down again through this very bleak hallway. The key finally works, and we get in. Okay, this is a dorm room, and not a comfy, light dorm room. This is one of those lovely, oppressive dorm rooms. Everything's gray, a little dingy. Not a big deal. It was air-conditioned. It was safe. We'd just spent some time living in a tent. A dorm room with AC was totally doable. Just wasn't what we expected. But then we saw them. Earwigs. Everywhere. They were on the floors. They were on the walls. They were in the sink. They were cannibalizing each other right next to my bed. And I started laughing. I just started laughing. I was giggling. I couldn't help it. I mean, come on, first world problems? Earwigs, not earwigs, anything but earwigs. I was definitely somewhat disgusted, but mostly I just couldn't stop giggling. At one point in time, my 14-year-old Leah came over, took me by the shoulders, looked at me, and said, "Mama, this really isn't funny." That didn't help my giggling. I might have giggled further. I said to her, I was like, you know, I could get upset about this. I could get angry and annoyed, but what good is it going to do? Still holding my shoulder, she looked at me. She said, "Could you at least be neutral?" That was it. I just collapsed. I couldn't stop laughing. I laughed all the way back up to the front desk. I said, there's earwigs in there. It's a lot of them. She's like, "Oh, yeah, I know." You know? Yeah, well, it happens about once a year, the pine trees, and, you know, we only had the first floor cleaned and ready for guests. I'm like, okay. I'm still kind of giggling, but she let me look in another room that also had earwigs. We just decided to stick with the first one. It's whatever. We got back to the room, and I couldn't help it. I just kept giggling. I just giggled the whole time. I'm like, you can't make this up. This is hilarious. My poor kid. Poor Leah has been subjected to my giggling in inappropriate situations. well, inappropriate. At times when maybe other people would react in different ways. Maybe they wouldn't giggle. Maybe they'd get upset about something, or at least, oh, I'm so sorry. I do that sometimes. But sometimes, you know, when my teenagers do things, it's so teenager-y. I want to giggle. It's funny. I hate you, Mom. Really? That's funny? Yeah, it's funny. I don't take myself too seriously. I've been practicing rule number 6 for a long time. Don't take yourself too damn seriously. If I took myself more seriously, I'd have probably gotten very upset about that, right? But it's, come on. First world problems? Come on. So they're earwigs. They're not going to eat me. It did take a little while for me to fall asleep that night. It's just itching thinking about it. But it's okay. We've talked a lot about spiritual disciplines in this last year. This is another one that I want to introduce you to if we haven't talked about it already. And this is the practice of joy. The spiritual discipline of joy. When you choose to be amused by something rather than being upset by it. Right? You choose joy. Whenever possible. I love to joke around. I love to enjoy life. I love to find joy in every situation. There are times I need to take things seriously. There are serious things that happen in the world. They're sad. They're hard. And we work hard to rectify them. Honestly, practicing joy isn't just for ourselves. It's about making sure that everybody can have joy. So sometimes we have to seriously do things to make sure everybody has joy. But we can't take ourselves too seriously while we do it, or we'll lose our own joy. We need to practice joy. So I love this spiritual discipline. So when I was in a bookstore a few weeks ago, and I saw this book, The Book of Joy, I had to get it. I had to pick this up, and I had to read it. I'm not all the way through yet. I'm maybe about a third of the way through so far, but I'm loving it. It's great. This, I don't know if you can see the people here, this is the Dalai Lama, and this is Bishop Desmond Tutu. This book is a story about a week they spent together. It's not written directly by them, but it's written by somebody who observed this week of conversations. It was a week of conversing about joy. My favorite parts about this book aren't necessarily the parts when they're saying how to find joy, but when they exhibit it. When they simply are joyful and show their mischievous sides. These two men may be world-renowned. They may be leaders in their respective religions. They may have suffered, and they have, unimaginable and horrifying challenges like apartheid and exile from their own lands, but they are clearly schooled in the nuance of rule number 6. Let me read you a short section. During the week, their fingers were often wagging at each other teasingly. Moments before their hands were clasped together affectionately. During our first lunch, the Archbishop told the story of a talk they were giving together. They were in some other part of the world. As they were getting ready to walk on stage, the Dalai Lama, the world's icon of compassion and peace, pretended to choke his spiritual older brother in fun. The Archbishop turned to the Dalai Lama and said, "Hey, the cameras are on us. Act like a holy man." Love this. These two men remind us that how we choose to act each day is what matters. Even holy men sometimes have to act like holy men. But how we think holy men act, serious and severe, pious and reserved, is hardly how these two greet the world or each other. The Archbishop has never claimed sainthood, and the Dalai Lama considers himself a simple monk. They offer us the reflection of real lives filled with pain and turmoil, in the midst of which they have been able to discover a level of peace, of courage, of joy that we can aspire to in our own lives. Their desire for this book is not just to convey their wisdom, but their humanity as well. Suffering is inevitable, they said, but how we respond to suffering is our choice. Not even oppression or occupation can take away this freedom to choose our response. These men and King David would have understood one another. There will always be the Mikhails in the world who scoff and take themselves too seriously. But we are called to something better. We are called to follow the Lord of the dance. This is something more joy-filled, something more profound that is far too important to miss by taking ourselves too damn seriously. We are called to follow the Lord of the dance. Let us take joy seriously. But we can only do so if we don't take ourselves too seriously. So let us, like David, dance before the Lord with all our might. Now this is your turn to dance. Will you dance? Let's dance. Got a little bit of Footloose? You can do this, people. Don't take yourself too damn seriously. There we go.
Everybody cut loose. Cut loose. Cut loose. Cut loose.
beloved God, we thank you for joy. We thank you for dancing. We thank you for children who remind us that truly it is as we come before you like children that we know you and you know us. Help us always to not take ourselves too seriously and to have a little fun and dance. Amen.
I don't know, you don't turn joy on just because somebody tells you to, and you don't shut it off just because it's whatever time it is, right? But we pray. Prayers for my grandfather as he faces health issues of old age, and for my grandmother as she cares for him. Lord, in your mercy, prayers. Prayers for Reverend Leon Atkins, who fell yesterday. Prayers for healing for him. Lord, in your mercy. Prayers of gratitude for this person's nephew's, whose brain lesion was benign. Lord, in your mercy. Prayers. And prayers of gratitude for the fun and energy of visiting family. Lord, in your mercy. God, thank you for the gift of the day, for the choices that we can make, how we can choose joy and grace and forgiveness and life and love, how we can choose to be patient, how we can choose to stay on our own side of the street, not to take ourselves too seriously, how we can choose to follow Jesus wherever his footsteps might lead us, how we can choose to be gentle with each other and gracious to our neighbors. Thank you for the choices we can make with regard to our resources, our money and our time and our talent. Thank you for the power of the word that can remind us of joyful roots that can strengthen us in the midst of difficult decisions, that can beckon to us toward a future that is desperate for a vision of grace and love. Thank you that we can every day choose to welcome the gift of your Spirit into our own lives, to be hospitable with one another, to extend ourselves to a stranger. We're grateful for all of the blessings that surround us and fill us in the midst of all the choices we have to make. We hold these concerns and others in our prayers now as we pray in the words Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to give our gifts and our tithes, and we're going to sing. It's in the small black hymnal, number 2184. And I think Adam's going to lead us. Is that correct, Adam? All right.
So we're going to do this once in Spanish and then once in English. So I'm going to sing it. So if you would rather wait till the English comes along, that's fine. But if you'd like to sing in Spanish with me, I'm going to sing in Spanish just now. But I don't have the book, so I'm just going to look on with you. Or why don't I just grab a book?
Enviado soy de Dios, mi mano lista está para construir con él un mundo fraternal. Enviado soy de Dios, mi mano lista está para construir con él un mundo fraternal. Los ángeles no son enviados a cambiar un mundo de dolor por un mundo de paz. Me ha tocado a mí hacerlo realidad. Ayúdame, Señor, a hacer tu voluntad. Sent out in Jesus' name, our hands are ready now to make the earth a place in which the kingdom comes. Sent out in Jesus' name, our hands are ready now to make the earth a place in which the kingdom comes. The angels cannot change a world of hurt and pain into a world of love, of justice, love, of peace. The task is ours to do, to set it really free. Oh, help us to obey and carry out your will. Sent out in Jesus' name, we're ready now to make the earth a place in which the kingdom comes. Sent out in Jesus' name, our hands are ready now to make the earth a place in which the kingdom comes. The angels cannot change a world of hurt and pain into a world of love, of justice, love, and peace. The task is ours to do, to set it really free. Oh, help us to obey and carry out your will.
A few announcements. We have a few announcements, and then we have a prayer of blessing. The announcements, first of all, next Sunday, right, Bruce, is the pig roast. Two Sundays from now. I'm sorry. That's right. There's two more Sundays in July. July 29th. So two Sundays from now is the potluck pig roast. You want to say something about it? I have a note here about asking for somebody to help with a parking thing. I guessed that. Bruce wants to is asking for a volunteer to help out handing out the free parking passes for when people come to Oak Ledge. So see him after church if you're willing to help hand those out. See Bruce? That's Bruce. So if you're willing to help hand out the free parking passes so people can park at Oak Ledge for free, it's at Oak Ledge Park, which is in the southern part of Burlington, right on the lake. It's a lovely time. Come out and have some fun with us. Bring a potluck dish. There'll be plenty of pork to go around, or plenty of pig to go around. The pork roast is so good. And just a reminder, make sure you bring your own plates and utensils and cups, and bring yourself a lawn chair. It'll be a great time, so come out for that. Other announcements, tomorrow the main office is closed in the church. Our administrative assistant is on a short vacation, so she won't be around, just so you know that. And the last things that I have is there's not going to be a Taze service tonight or in August. We're just going to take the summer off. We'll be back in September, but just so you know, no Taze services this month or next. But there is a big Taze thing happening starting this week, so I want to ask Michaelin to come on up. Will you come on up, Michaelin? We have been preparing to send Michaelin to Taze with our bishop, and we want to pray for her. So we're gonna bring her into the center here, and we're going to lay hands on her, and we're going to pray for Michaelin. Come on over. So if you'll come around, and we're gonna lay our hands on Michaelin and say a prayer. Taze is a monastic community in France where this beautiful chant-like music happens, and young people from all over the world will gather. So we're going to pray for Mikaelin, and if you can't actually touch her, touch somebody who is, or raise your hand, and we're going to pray a blessing on Mikaelin. Oh, beloved God, we pray for your daughter Mikaelin as she travels this week. As the journey takes her far away, we pray that it will bring her closer to your heart. We pray that the time that she spends in Teze will be a blessing for her and for all who journey with her. And we pray that it will be a blessing for us when she comes back and when she shares with us the joys of this journey. We pray that the journey itself will be safe and the love that she experienced will be nourishing. In your good and gracious name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. Yay, Mikaelin. All right. I think those are the announcements that we have. A reminder to sign a prayer. There's a prayer letter in the back. Remember to sign that. And we're going to go into our closing hymn. Now, this is a closing hymn you will be vaguely familiar with. You have all heard and sung, "Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing." I'm sorry. Yes. Yes, that is right. It's just missing a piece. "Oh, for a thousand tongues." But this is Mark Miller's version of it. So it's going to sound a little bit different. And if you feel like dancing, by golly, dance. Because that's what it's about. Let us sing our closing hymn together.
You'll get the hang of it. It's pretty easy. Just follow me. And Mark. Mostly Mark.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of his grace, the triumphs of his grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad, the honor of thy name, the honors of thy name. Jesus, the name that charms all fears, that bids a sorrow cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace, 'tis life and health and peace. He speaks, and listening to his voice, new life the dead receive. The mournful broken hearts rejoice, the humble poor believe, humble poor believe. Hear him, ye deaf, his praise, ye dumb, your loosened tongues employ. Ye blind, behold your Savior come, and leap ye lame for joy, and leap ye lame for joy. For a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumph of his grace.
I don't know, I just want to keep singing. You want to do another verse? All right.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of his grace, the triumphs of his grace, his grace.
into joy, and you call us to share it with whomever we meet. We pray that you would take us from this place, that we might be your joy-filled people, and that we would go out into the world bringing joy wherever we might be and to whomever we are called to be with. Give us grace. Give us joy. Guide us forward always. In your name we pray. Amen. And may the peace and joy of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Let us pass peace and joy together this day.